Morning, JFC. How's everyone? Good morning, church. How is everyone who's happy that it is December? Can I hear an amen? Amen. My favorite month, because it's Jesus' and my birthday. Amen. For those that are outside, I know you can hear us. So let's come in. It's 10 o'clock. It's quarter past 10, actually. So let's find our seats. Let's all stand up. Who's excited to be at church this morning? Can I hear a wave or see a wave? Not hear a wave. Can I hear a clap? Can I hear you clap your hands? Oh, very good, very good, very good. Let's just open up in prayer and we'll just get straight into it. Father, we just thank you that we can come here together to celebrate, to come here and worship you. Father, we just thank you for this Sunday that you have brought us here to church, that you've brought us here for a reason. I just pray, God, that Holy Spirit, that you would just come and fill this place, that your presence will be in this place. We just thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's clap our hands together, church. Nice and loud, church. Who am I that you are mindful of me, that you hear me when I call? Is it true that you are thinking of me, how you love me? Let's sing it out from the beginning. Who am I that you are mindful of me, that you hear me when I call? Is it true? Is it true that you are thinking of me?
Yes, it is.
How you love me. It's amazing.
Let's see, it's amazing.
It's amazing.
Who am I?
Who am I that you are mindful of me, that you hear me when I call? Is it true that you are thinking of me, how you love me? It's amazing.
It's one more time.
It's amazing.
Me.
Isn't he amazing?
Yes.
Amen. Amen.
Let's clap our hands together, church. Who breaks the power of sin?
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonders? The King of glory, the King above all kings.
Let's sing it out, church.
This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you will take my place. That you will bear my cross. You lay down your life. That I will be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Who brings our chaos back into order?
Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphans the son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you will take my place. That you will bear my cross. The Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
Thank you for all that you've done for us. our God amazing? Thank you, Jesus. Joy to the world,
joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive the King. Let every heart prepare Him room, and heaven and nature sing.
Sing joy to the world,
joy to the world.
Joy to the world,
joy to the world, the Savior reigns. Let all their songs employ, while fields and floods, rocks, hills and plains, repeat the sounding joy. And wonders of His love.
Yes, Lord. Joy to the world.
Joy to the world. The Lord is come. Let earth receive a King. Let every heart prepare Him room. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven.
Your name is the highest.
Your name is the greatest. Your name, it stands above them all. All thrones and dominions, all powers and positions. Your name, it stands above them all.
Jesus,
your name is the highest. Your name is the greatest. Your name, it stands above them all. All thrones and dominions, all powers and positions. Holy, holy.
Father God. Father God, we thank you that your name is lifted high above all else, Father God, that your name is holy and that your name is exalted, Father God. And Lord, we just come together as the family of God, Lord. And Father, when we're part of a family, when one part of the family is suffering, we suffer with them. When I found out that my uncle in England had a stroke, inside my heart I was crying. When I found out my family in New Zealand was sick, my heart was crying with them. But together today, I want to say that we are the family of God, and our Father is a Father God. And all over the world today, we have family who are part of Jesus' family or connected to Jesus' family, whether they're in Cabramatta or Parramatta or in Asia or in America, in any part of the world, we have family who are suffering today, and we want to stand with them and say that as children of God, we know that we have a God who is looking down on us, who wants to come and bring healing, and that through the name of our Father God, his name is holy and lifted up, and we want to come together and just bring them before his throne of grace. So just join your voices with me as we pray for them. Father God, we just thank you, Father God, that you are a God that brings healing. You are a God whose name is high and exalted and has power. We thank you that the name of Jesus is greater than any other name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that you are Lord. And we thank you that there is power, that there is healing in your name, that there is salvation in your name. And right now we want to lift up Shreya to you. We want to lift up Pastor Graham to you, and also Pastor Patty and Christine and Stan. Father God, many of us, they are connected to us and part of our church, Father God, part of our church family, and we love them dearly, Father God, and we just pray for them, Father God. We pray right now that you'll come and bring your healing upon them, Father God, that you'll come and bring restoration, that you'll come and restore the parts of their body that are sick and that are suffering, Father God. We also lift up to you those who are standing here today who may be sick, and those who are not here today because they are sick, Father God. We lift them up to you, Father God, and we just pray your healing power come and touch their bodies, come and touch their mind, come and touch their spirit, and bring supernatural healing, Father God. We lift them up to you in Jesus' name. We thank you, Father God, in Jesus' name.
Your hand upon
could separate. You tore the veil. You tore the veil. You made a way. When you said that it is done, you tore the veil tore before you. You silenced the voice of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring the praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again.
You have no rival.
You have no rival. You have name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is, nothing compares to this. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah, what a powerful name it is. Thank you so much, Tim. Thank you, singers. Amen. Hallelujah. What a powerful name is. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you so much, singers. Good morning, church. Let us give glory to God. Hallelujah. Who is here? Let us see our hand. Amen. Jesus is with us. What a beautiful name, the name of Jesus. Amen. We're coming to our special time, our special moment of offering and tithing. As Peter said when they start singing, December is the special month. How many people born in December? Oh, we know many. That's all right. Jesus is born in December, so we're sharing birthday with Jesus. Thank you so much, Jesus, for letting us to be here this morning, and thank you so much for this opportunity to share offering and tithing. This is the end of the month, which is preparing us to go to start another new year. So I was counting the blessings Jesus has given to us from January till today. It is a lot. If you count your blessing, you can't name all. You can't name them all. There are so many. And this is the time everyone is getting ready to buy a gift, because this is the time we show gratitude, time to show love to our beloved and friend. So I was walking to the shop the other day. I see how things are getting so expensive. And I compare to years ago, how much $50 used to be useful. Then I ask myself, now $50, you can't buy nothing. I can't even buy my little one shoes. Then I ask myself how people are going to continue being faithful by giving their offering and tithe to the kingdom of God. So I came to this word in the psalm, but then I give a definition myself. I say, we have to continue to acknowledge that God is the source of everything. God is the source of whatever we have. He is our provider. When I read the book of Psalm 23, just verse 1, it is a famous chapter. It is a famous verse to me, and I think many people do read this. So this verse declares that the Lord is our shepherd and our provider. When we trust in him and follow his lead, we lack nothing. God is able to provide for us for all our needs, and we can trust his loving and care and provision. It doesn't matter how things are going around the globe. I'm sure it's not expensive in Australia, the elsewhere is okay. No, life has been changing everywhere, but in all, we have to keep trusting God. Let us show our gratitude. Let us be generous, because our God loves us. I'm sure David, when he was writing this chapter, he went through many things, and he thought about the goodness of God. So for me too, I was saying, still, God is our shepherd. So if he is our shepherd, we should not lack nothing. So I encourage you, whatever you go through, whatever little you have, God has provided you, remember he is the source of everything. He is the source of our life, our breathing, our everyday life. So he is the one who provides whatever we have. So let us trust him, and let us pray, and trusting that he's going to provide more. Just believe and trust him. Stretch your arm and say, God, I need you. If you didn't get today, remember next time God will bless you with. Let us pray. Dear Father, we give you glory. We thank you for the gift of life you have given us this morning again, Lord. We thank you for your provision. We thank you for your protection. As we're stretching our arm to give out our offering and tithing, Father, we want you to bless each person in this room. May you touch the heart of your people and everyone who didn't get nothing to give it to you today. May you bless them. Next time, they can have a word with you. They can have something to thank you, Jesus. Father, we thank you and we trust you, and we know that you are our Father. You are our shepherd. We should lack nothing, Lord. We trust you and we believe in your word. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Well, good morning, everyone. Good to see you this morning. Trust all of you are enjoying your time. If this is your first time in this church, can I see your hand this morning? Anyone first time? Great to have one young man over there. Welcome. Trust you'll enjoy your time here. That's great. If there are others that don't want to be known, that's fine. You are welcome to still also enjoy the time together. We have three announcements that we're going to have today. Peter Boyd is going to be showing us something on the building, where it's up to. Milan and the team have come back from Nepal, will be sharing something, and Denise is going to say something now.
Talofa, everyone. Okay, so this is announcement for Christmas Day. Our Christmas Day is going to fall on the 24th, which is a Sunday, 24th of December. That is going to be our Christmas service. It is going to be a short service followed by a concert. So if you are interested in doing a performance or an item, please come see myself and then we'll sort out the program. And then there will be light refreshments straight afterwards. Okay, so if you want to do an item, come and see me. Also, just to let you know, you're wondering if the toilets are closed. The toilets over there are closed. There's toilets on the right. So outside, turn right and the toilets are here. And left, right and left. Toilets. Bye.
Thank you, Denise. So I hope you got from that there is no actual Christmas service, because we don't lease this. Wait, your patience. Yeah, you're next, but not quite. Yeah. Boy, do your sons do that to you? hey, I've lost my train. Yeah, because we're not hiring the building on a Monday, so we can't use the building. We have nowhere to have a Christmas service. Plus, we normally don't have one straight after the Sunday, then have another one the next day. Peter, would you like to come and show us where we're going with the building? I'm in control, remember that.
Sorry, guys. Sorry, Dad. Yes, who wants to know what's happening with the building? Yeah? Okay. I have a video so you can see what's happening in there. It is 3 minutes, so it is a little bit long. But watch it, and then I think everything explains for itself where we're at. So if we can have the guys at the back. Can I have the lights? Yes. Probably should be doing some commentary. It's the guys putting the beam in. So this is probably how it is looking right now today. So we're getting there. So it is a big beam, but it is to open up the auditorium more, which you will see once it's completed. This is the crane. Yes, I jumped really high to take that photo. Up in the building, I just went up to one of the flats on the side. Okay. You'll see that, okay. Going upstairs. Not much upstairs, it's pretty empty at the moment. I don't know why I put that in there. So there's upstairs. Just different aspects of it. So this is the lift shaft installation on the ground floor, and this is upstairs. So this is for, and the stairs right next to the lift. It's all concreted now, so it's all ready. Okay, this is just me walking through the building, so just so that everyone can get a visual in its full entirety. Sorry, it's a bit blurry and shaky. Toilets, very important for those that need it during Sunday. So you can see the stairs are located quite in a very different place to where it was originally. So you'll see that the previous staircase is now completely gone and filled up. Look at the hole. That's just a lower perspective, so you can see how the auditorium will be. Just quickly go upstairs. That's me just trying to hurry up. Okay. So upstairs will be where the Mighty Kids will be meeting, Mini Mites. There's going to be toilets there, and the kitchen will be in that corner, same as in the previous building layout. Okay, that's me just hurrying it up. Okay. The lift from downstairs. And we're going to be walking to where the pastor's office is. That is a hole at the moment. I don't know why I was just staring at that, but that's... turn around there. So there has been a slight delay with the DA, which we are expected to get approval this week. So it has been extended that we are expecting completion in June 2024. So another 6 months, unfortunately, but that's where we're at. So the big, structural work has been done. And so now from here till when we move in, a lot of changes are going to happen to the building. You're going to start seeing all the different rooms and all the finishes and the roof and the ceiling and everything get done. So that's the update for November. Milan.
Hannah, you want to come forward? Awesome. Good to see you, everyone. How's Sarah's doing this morning? Good, awesome. So we just got our team back two weeks now from Nepal. We had an amazing trip. Besides being overfed, it was a really, really, really good trip. So before we have some clips that we want to show, but before we do that, I would just, Hannah has something to say. That'd be great.
Jamasi. Meronam Hanaho, which means my name is Hannah. That's all I can learn from Nepal. It's my pleasure to share what we have been experiencing. It's just 5 minutes that I have up here, so I try to get it very short. But I would love to share more with you if you know on the personal conversation. But I would like to open my sharing with a prayer from my sister before we left. So she prayed that, Lord, break their hearts for what break yours. And I really believe what I have experienced through this trip is because God answered her prayer. So as someone who was born and grown up in Vietnam, which was still a third world country 30, 40 years ago, my first impression of Nepal was the familiarity of my childhood. How mum and dad raised me, you know, even the street, the rice fields, the infrastructure, the pollution in the air, the poverty, the silent oppression in the society where cultures, religions, and traditions lead the way. So Nepal reminds me a lot of that for the first time that I've been there. Yet the people hospitality was so, so warm-hearted and thoughtful, especially in the church. Their smiles is gold, and they're very beautiful without them realizing it. Because of this background of Nepal, the people's heart was really crying for spiritual reality. And usually they end up with pseudo, you know, spirituality. We, in this blessed country in Australia, we have so many options, and God can become one of our options in our life. But over there, when their lives was in pitch darkness, they don't have any support from government, from family, from even their own employment. All they need is a savior. So I hope I won't offend any of you guys here when I say this. I myself would love to go to Israel one day. I would love to walk on the street where Jesus walked and felt the vibe where Jesus felt. But I realized on my way back home here that I have met many people similarity to the gospel through this trip. I have seen and prayed for someone who was like Zacchaeus, who had short status. He literally has short status, but his heart was running after Jesus, where Jesus was. I've spoken, pray for hours and explained John 4 to a lady because I saw her so much alike the Samaritan woman who was hopeless in her situation, and all she was crying out was a man who could save her out of loneliness and confusion. I saw many Marthas, you know, Mary and Marthas, many Marthas there who has serving hearts, yet they burn out because of restlessness, of worries and cares of lives. So I was so grateful to have the privilege to speak and pray with them. Just that I haven't met Lazarus yet because it's quite challenging to raise someone from the dead. So the story of the gospel really spoke to me again through this trip, and I felt Jesus' heart vividly when I met these people face to face. It's not just on the page, it's actually real people. And I was so thankful for JFC, for the pastors and the leadership here to establish the community there and speak lives into these people. And the church was very supportive and helping us to connect with the local people, especially a lot of them were not Christian as well. So we spent time with them, ate at their house and prayed with them. I felt the family value was so well established in JFC churches in Nepal. Not only the main church, but also in the Mighty Kids. They share and care for one another with a genuine faith. So I had a privilege to participate in the Mighty Kids service, both in Itahari and Kathmandu while the main service was happening. And it just felt like I was in Cabramatta every week. The only difference is that one of them has the kids service up on the rooftop of the house instead of the classrooms like us. So I would like to close my sharing with this story of this beautiful girl that we happened to meet her. She was a big surprise for all of us there, including the congregation at the conference. So I got the picture of her here. Her name is Jessica Rai. She's about 5 or 6 years old. So she's a daughter of a pastor, and her dad just became a pastor for JFC Church in one of the branch around 1 hour ago, like driving from Itahari. So that is her family, and that's the church just started. It's only started with 2 families. So she's the daughter of one of the pastors there. So we visited her church on Sunday, just before the conference. So she knew us before the conference. So during the conference, she was always sitting with us. And she loved drawing. So, you know, while the sermon's happening, she didn't understand. She just drew sitting on my laps. And she drew pictures of all of us in the team. So I will share with you some of her drawings. So she drawing, you can see the next slide. Pretty cute. Can you guess who's Namrata, who's Hannah, and who Consi? So Consi has the braided hair, so that's how she drew it. And then on top was Namrata, and myself is a little bit tall. And then she named us, like she wrote our names next to one of us, and she did it all by herself. She asked us, what's your name? And then she put the name there. And then the next picture, she drew, I think she drew Matthew, Merv, but maybe she was too tired, so now she skipped the naming part. But I want to go back to the previous slide. Yes, Merv has muscle, that's why he's... when she wrote this name, this was picked up by Namrata because she could understand Nepalese. So she put the name each, and you can see the similarity in three of us. Can you guess? The last name was the same, yes. So her name is Jessica Rai, and she named us Hannah Rai, Namrata Rai, and Consi Rai. It's so beautiful, and you know, she didn't look at us as how we look different. We're different in our skin color, in our language. I couldn't speak to her in Nepalese. Only Namrata could speak to her. But the way she put her family name in, you know, at each of our names, it's just God spoke to this girl through the conference that regardless of how you look, how you feel, is God always see us in his family. And we are as a big family of God. So I hope that will bless you today.
Very good. Thanks, Anna. Yeah, before we just saw the clip, I just have a few words. We seven of us were there. Myself, Mer, Matt, Aquella, Hannah, Namrat, and Consi. So we were being looked after really, really, really well during our whole time over there in Nepal. We were there for 2 weeks. It was just amazing, amazing time, just connecting with the families and friends. And one thing that really struck me during this trip was this whole sense of like, you know, we're going to the church, there are churches there, like visiting different churches in eastern part of Nepal. And even before we reached the church, like we just felt like, this is home. Like, you know, we went there and we met the families and we met the, you know, the church, pastors, and we were just connecting with them. And we just felt like this is just like in Cabramatta. Like, this is like, there's the same DNA that what we have here, exactly the same atmosphere, same warmth, same, you know, the love, the genuine love that our people has for you. So it was incredible, and we were at Kathmandu, same thing, like Consi and Namrata, and I'm pretty sure Hannah's. They've never been to our JFC Kathmandu before, so before even we reached the actual main gate there, I remember Consi saying, like, this is just feels like going to Cabramatta Church. Like, I haven't even been to church inside, so which is so good. So I just want to say thank you. You know, and the whole trip there, like, we just had this conversation coming up, and it was just like we were just sitting there in awe, like saying, like, I'm pretty sure Merv and all of us, we agree with this this idea of like how you know, many years ago, two couples, one couple who actually you know, like decided to move to Australia, and then have decided to, you know, plant the church here in Cabramatta, made that possible for us to actually go now and just visit the church, like what's happening there. So can we all please, you know, at least acknowledge our pastors, David and Sion. So it was really, really, just want to say thank you, massive thank you to Pastor David and Sion for really, you know, obeying the call of God and we are being part of that now. Like, it's so incredible. So we just want to show some video before we end. But like, before we do that, I would just like to say thank you to everyone who contributed to this mission trip. Like, whether it was through giving or through prayers or whatever, the word of encouragement, we really felt it. And it was like, we kind of like, oh yes, like, this trip was so good because the people are praying for us back home. So thank you again, church. So we'll end up with this video clip. So just enjoy it. Thank you.
And what God has done in my life. In my life, I've seen God work many miracles.
Is it good that I saved his life? Is it good that I do good to him?
Like,
that
when we fix our eyes on Jesus,
he
will do miracles. Our overthinking
and our worrying,
the virus,
the smartest group of people,
the ones who are from the royal family and
noble
family.
So you ask me how come I have become young, because I hang out with a lot of young people in my church. Never been a solo Christian. And it's my joy to be here.
Scripture says, I'll get you from the bottom of the sea, man.
Yeah, bro. How crazy. So this is another site, JFC site.
He's a leader of this JFC, husband and wife.
This was in Biratnagar, very close to India.
right.
This was in Tehran. Yeah, that's how you do stretching after 10 hours bus ride. So Mardik is in Kathmandu. Thank you. So that was the trick.
Great. Who wants to go on a trip? Excellent. Okay, I'm going to call, not Hannah, Rebecca.
Good morning, church. I always find that when you step out and serve God, you get just as big a blessing back as what you sow into people's lives. And when you look at that trip, that's certainly, I think, the experience of the team as well, which is just how God blesses us over and over again. Amen. This morning, I wanted to start by reading John 19:28. Later, knowing that everything had been finished, and so that the scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, "I am thirsty." And a jar of wine vinegar was there. So they soaked a sponge in it, put the sponge on a stalk of the plant, and lifted it to Jesus' lips. When he received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished." With that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Have you ever had one of those days or weeks or months when you kind of reach as far as you can reach? It's like your thermometer's peaked or your barometer's at the top. Recently, I had kind of one of those periods of time. The housework was overwhelming and the kids needed to be all over the place. There were health issues, there were family issues, there were complexities at work, and I'd reached my point. I know I'd reached my point because I tend to not like baths. I don't like baths. They're a waste of time in my perspective. But when you really reached your peak, somehow I seem to just go and turn the bath on, maybe hoping that the water will just soak away some of the stresses and the pain and you can kind of configure. So I was switching the bath on and the words came to me, "It is finished." I think to myself, it's not very encouraging. Are you saying that, you know, my health concerns are, it's finished, that's the end? Or are you saying, you know, the relationships that are an issue, that's the end? Not sure I'm kind of getting what it means, it is finished. Perhaps I was looking for a word that was be strong and courageous, or fear not, for I am with you. They would have been useful right about then. But it came, it is finished. And I think what I was supposed to get out of it, and I began to think, what does it mean, it is finished? And see, when Jesus said it was finished, it was meaning that the work on the cross was done. Our salvation, our redemption, our eternal life was complete and sealed in Jesus Christ forever. Amen. And so what I was struggling with was temporal. It was something that was just in the present time, and that my God was victorious, he was greater, and he was going to overcome. You see, I've been a Christian for over 40 years now, and I seem to need to remember that the victory was done on the cross for us. And you need to sometimes, as Christians, remember that over and over again. So I began to shift my thinking and not look at the present and remember that God was victorious and that God was the overcomer and God was the conqueror, and my shoulders began to lift. And you felt a peace that's beyond understanding in your current circumstance. And as we come today, maybe you've got your highs and your lows in your life. Maybe you've got a struggle. Maybe you're feeling a little bit heavy weighted by the burdens of today. The finances are coming in, the busyness of the Christmas season, all of those things. Maybe you've got some health issues or you've got family that are in need. You need to remember today as we come to the cross. That's why we take communion, right? Is to remember that Jesus overcame it all for us and that through him we have eternal life. And through him, he can give us the peace and understanding despite our circumstances. Amen. So let's stand this morning. I want to thank God for what he did for us on Calvary. Heavenly Father, Lord God, you're a good God. You sent Jesus for us, and he died on the cross so that we may have everlasting life. Lord Jesus, I pray for my family members here today that despite whatever circumstance that they come against, despite the pressures of life or the complexities of issues that they're coming through in today, that they know that you are with them. You are the conqueror. You are the great I am. You are the one who died and rose again for us so that we can have eternal life with you and that we can rest and relax knowing that you are in control of all things. Lord Jesus, we thank you for the victory on the cross and we thank you that every day we walk with you in Jesus' name. Amen. Please partake.
Just before Uong comes to minister, just a reminder that after the service, we're having lunch together outside. You're allowed to take some chairs out to sit on if you want to and have some fellowship before we go home. So Uong, over to you.
Christmas is coming. How many of you enjoy Christmas? I must confess that I do. Well, Last sermons, I was supposed to come here and share with you in the book of Psalms, and then I share from, you know, the blessed of the overcomers. And then some people are asking, I expect to come and see you share with me Psalm as well. I say, yes, I'll come back to share with you Psalms. So turn with me with the Bible. You got the NIV one is good. That's that one that I will read. If you don't, you can turn your own version there. It's Psalm 37. It's beautiful Psalms. I shared these Psalms in Marrickville a few months ago, but it's the reason why I cannot share with you in Psalm 38 because I can't jump ship. I have to share systematically from Psalm 1 to this Psalm here. Let me pray. Thank you, Father, Lord God, you are a Father through Jesus Christ. And this morning, we alongside with others, brother and sister, even though they're different denominations, but they come to your church to worship you. Lord, be with us here, be with others. Let the own have our heart and our mind to devote it to you. Lord, once a week we come together to enjoy fellowship first above all else, it's with you and with each other. And then we have good and we have all these church activities to prepare us for tomorrow's, we are come back to ordinary work. And thank you for your spirit with here. We invite you. We welcome you. Lord, be with us. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Psalm 37, have you got it there? The title for my sermon today is Life Only Worth Living When You Know How to Trust and Delight in the Lord. The psalm is long, but it's not long, is it? Because the omen in this psalm here, the psalm reads here, do not fret because of those who are evil or be envious for those who do wrong. For like the grass, they will soon wither. Like green plants, they will soon die away. Verse 3 is very important. Say, trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and enjoy safe pasture. Verse 4 is wonderful. Delight in the Lord, and he will give you desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord and trust in Him, and He will do this. He will make your righteous reward shine like dawn, your vindications like noonday sun. And verse 7 says, be still before the Lord and wait patiently for Him. Do not fret when people succeed in their ways, when they carry out their wicked scheme. Refrain from anger and turn from wrath. Do not fret. It leads you to only to evil. For those who are evil will be destroyed, but those who hope in the Lord will inherit the land. A little while and the wicked will be no more. Those who look for them, they will not be found. Verse 11. But the meek will inherit the land and enjoy peace and prosperity. The wicked bless against the righteous and gnash their teeth at them, but the Lord laughs at the wicked, for He knows their way is coming. The wicked draw their sword and bend their bow and bring down the poor and the needy to slay those who are upright. But their sword will pierce their own heart, and their bows will be broken. Better be little in the righteous health than the wealth of the wicked. For the power of the wicked will be broken, but the Lord upholds righteous. The blameless spend their days under the Lord's care, and their inheritance will endure forever. And keeping on here, and then I skip a bit to verse 23. I said, the Lord makes firm the steps of the one who delight in Him. Though he may stumble, he will not fall, for the Lord upholds him with His hand. I was young, and now I am old. Yet I have never seen righteous forsaken or their children being begging bread. They are always generous and lend freely. Their children will be a blessing. Turn from evil and do good, then you will dwell in the land forever. And keep it on there. I don't want to read anymore. You can read at home, but this is beautiful Psalms. It's in the Psalm, we open the Psalm with a good. Do not fret. Fret, it means do not feel anxious, or don't feel anxiety, or don't fly into passions. The Bible makes it clear for us, and sometimes, you know, if everything is okay, life is okay, we all enjoy it. But hey, living this life here, living this world, nothing is going smooth as the people dream. The dreamers say life is smooth, but not. I can say it here, I'm more than 60 years of age. Life is always have up and down and something unexpected. Few years back, we have this COVID. When COVID attacks, you know, we live in Australia, you know, two of the world's best 10 cities here, Melbourne and Sydney. If you say, you know, the world's best 10 cities, Australia, we have two. But, you know, in those days, you know, the gift is not about something that big, just about two rows of toilets. And people in the market, they fight for toilet roll. And in the future, if you talk to your children and say, hey, in Australia here, in Melbourne, and in Sydney here, even the world's best cities, but in one time in the history, people fighting badly for just a toilet roll. And a Christmas gift. It's not something that more important, but just a couple of toilet rolls can bring some people happy. You know, remember that? And as I just some boy, you know, come to my family, you know, and we have a party meeting here, and then, you know, with our family members, okay, but here's a guy, you know, he's, you know, being an actor, you know, going to, you know, some of the best college, and I want to become, you know, actors, and then my wife's here, it's your Christmas gift. You know what it is? Two toilet rolls. And he's the way he's laughing, he enjoys and say, this is the best gift I ever get. That's in Sydney here a few years back. You know why? Because life is not something not unexpected. Suddenly, COVID come without people notice, and then information going so like a frenzy, driving the people. But here in the Bible, God say to you and they say to me, do not fret. Do not put so much anxiety. Trust in the Lord. And in the future, you could sing it, you know, in the future, and just nowadays, if you're talking to somebody, they say, you know, we fought for toilet rolls, they wouldn't believe it. I would love to video, you know, the actors come to my home and my wife give that toilet rolls and then they see the delight in his face there. But that's it. But that's it in the Bible telling you and telling me this psalm here, three times the word, do not fret, it's here. Verse 1, verse 7, and verse 8. Why? That's because we human being, we don't know things the future, and we don't know things that come to our way unexpected. And things always come. But the Lord, I said, the Lord say in verse 3, trust in the Lord and what? Trust in the Lord and do good. In our society, there could be millions of people are trusting in the Lord, but how many people say, it's the top line, it's the Bible, always have top line and bottom line. The top line is trust in the Lord. But the bottom line is doing good, because you're putting your trust, you're putting your faith into action. So a lot of us can trust in the mind, but many of us can say, yes, God say, trust in the Lord and do good. I don't know what about you, but when I'm watching the video, you know, the clips that our brother Milan just saw there, you don't have the emotion, don't you? But I do. The emotion is, you know, it's more than 30 years ago. You know, I was just out of the prisons, you know, and then my you know, my girlfriend, my fiance, you know, she's asking, I want to go to visit prison. And to you, the one who lived in prison for 10 years being tortured, prison is the last thing I ever want to go into it. And here's my girlfriend's beautiful, and she's young, and she called me and said, I want to go and see, go to visit people in prison because my student is there, and he saw me the newspaper. It's our Cambodian brother, then Ricky, there, so he's not here, but they say, we chop in a visit people in prison. And through that, you know, that Ricky and going out others there and come into the scene. You know, we thank God that the people here are, you know, brothers, David and Jesus and others in the church working together here and function now. There you see the big things happen in Nepal. But, you know, I always thinking back, yes, Lord, trust in the Lord and do good. Because the Bible want to tell us here, you can trust. You can have faith, but if you don't put that trust and have faith into actions and in doing good, your trust and your faith is just part of your human being. But you have first put have faith and trust and doing good, God will say, my sons and my daughters start to learn from Jesus sowing the seed. The seed of action there. The seed of something there. It's wonderful. See, you know, it says, trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and enjoy safe pasture. I enjoy living in this country for sure. Going to Nepal, you know. David went to Nepal first because after coming out of prison for 2 years, David kept promise and say, I'll come to visit you. I said, build it up. And next time I came with David. It's 1997, first time ever I went there. I thought I can go to the mountain. I thought I claimed doing this and doing that. But on halfway, I found out my knee swollen. I thought, hey, David, you might have to carry me. And David said, not me. I'll ask the porter, you know, carry you, you know. Well, but the thing is, you know, the joy of seeing the brother, the joy of seeing, you know, the nations there, I don't care much about being rich or being poor. I don't care so much about, you know, the scenery out there. What we do is we want to go and visit my brother. Visit the people that we invest ourselves into it. But thanks God for the faithful. Thank God for the church. Thank God for everything we put together to function together. And that's what the Bible says. Trust God. Trust Lord. And do good. And in living in the safe pasture. And verse 4 is wonderful. Verse 4 say, delight in the Lord, and what is? And he will give you desires of the heart. Here the Bible, taking you here, he is, the Bible doesn't say, hey, sitting there, and the Lord, you know, will insert the delight in your heart and your mind. It is here, you must take action. The psalmist says you take initiative, delight in the Lord. If you delight in the Lord, if you delight in the things, things will acting well. And you know, you have to remember, you know, it's life here. You have to invest your emotion. You have to invest your energy. You have to invest your intellect into the things that we do. That's what the Bible says. Take delight in the Lord because he's here. The Lord is here before you were born. And the Lord will still be here after you're gone. And he's here and he's expecting you and expecting me to delight in him. That's why the Bible says, take delight in him. Because when you take delight in him, and then what's the option? What's the next? And he'll give you the desires of the heart. In the world today, if you just open, you know, see in the world, you know, they don't delight in the Lord. And the world today, you know, I don't. The teaching of the world today is, you know, is the one have peace, have no desires at all. And I see, you know, our people over there, you know, they are going meditation over there. It's mean they try to kick out their heart, don't have a desire. And they delight in nothing. Yeah? Meditations in the world nowadays, it's about, you know, I don't have delight in the Lord. You know, I have no, you know, take delight in nothing. I just delight in, you know, everything is zero. Zeros equal nonsense. You see here in the Bible, say, take delight in the Lord, and what? And it gives you the desire of the heart. What desire for? Desire to do something good. Desire to do something beyond our norm. Our norm is take rest. No, raining day like this, you know, we prefer stay at home and then lying in bed, you know, watching in the world through that mobile phone, you know, reading in here. Did you read that up? I did some time on bed, you know, I take a mobile phone, you know, reading the whole world, you know, the news and everything's there, you know, reading there, and suddenly get up and now. I cannot see through the world through apples or Samsung. I want to see the world through the Bible. I want to see the world through God. I want to take delight in God, and I want to have this desire of the heart. It would get out there serving the Lord, even though, you know, sorry, as you said, I'm getting older, and this morning, and David say, he saw me, you know, walking up the staircase, hey, you walk a lot slower. I say, yes, I do. You too. Yeah. A long time ago, you know, about 30 years ago, you know, that's, you know, staircase I can jump to, you know, up there, you know, enjoy myself. Nowadays, if I do like that, I'm sure you would fall down, you know, because my knee doesn't allow me it. But that's not the point. The point is, you know, you're getting older, but God is still ever young. Did you know that? We can get older, but the Lord, our God, is ever young, ever the same. The Bible says God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's the same. But you are not. And I am not. This morning, I with some people, you know, for a long time, I not come to church and say, oh, wow, look in the church, and you are getting older. You got white hair. Well, thanks God, I'm getting white hair. Thanks God I'm getting slower. Thanks God that I'm getting older so that the younger people can go up and do better than me. Thanks God for some people getting older so that the young people say yes. They also trust in the Lord and doing good and sow the seed and doing something better than us, better than Uong, better than David, better than people in this church here. Isn't it? That's what God desires for you and for me. That's what Cole is. What Cole is, take delight in the Lord and He'll give you the desires of the heart. You delight in God, youngster, you know, and delight in God, and God say, I will serve God better than Pastor Uong, Pastor David. I could do something far beyond this older generations. I mean better, not worse. Okay? People tend to do something either better or worse, but I prefer, if God is ever the same, He will lead you, He will guide you. You have a desire to serve God better than the older generations. I read King David. I'm sure David, King David, never speak Vietnamese. King David 3,000 years ago never speak Nepalese, never speak Hindi, never speak English either. But in our generation here, we speak English, we speak language, we speak, you know, something that beyond King David. Now that you're talking David, say, hey, King David, I got this Apple, I got this Samsung. David says, what's that? Because we're better. We have information much faster than King David before, but God expecting you have a desire of the heart. You serve God better. You trust the Lord firmer, and you go beyond the older generation. That's what the Bible wants to teach you and want to teach me. And the word, commit your way to the Lord. And then, you know, yes, of course, you know, I jump a bit here because my time is gone because I smell the onions out there. And the verse 7 say, be still before the Lord and wait. What? The adverb in here is very important. Wait patiently. Human being, especially people in these generations, everything's available. If you want to know the information, punching into the Apple or the Samsungs, there, the Google can tell you everything. I like at home, and sometimes the children, they're talking, I forgot that word, you know. Wiki, you know, and then just punching in and you're talking, you know, really, you know, and that, and then they could talk to you and they tell you all the information in the world, isn't it? Now that you know, information is easy, you know, if I'm preaching here, I use the word things here, just go Google, if Pastor Uong said that word right, you know, they could tell you know. It's nowadays, but it's not, everything's available. We live in the world with instant coffee, instant noodles, instant friendship, instant everything. But God's still asking you and asking me, wait for Him, what? Patiently. It's teaching you and teaching me how to live in this world, how to function. Normally in this world here, we often very rush in our decision, we rush in our good, we rush in even our conversations. That's why the conversation go nowhere, no benefit. But if you can wait patiently and work and function patiently in this society, God will say, will answer you. And that's how we, you know, we live in this instance, and then we're asking God, I want you to answer me now. And right away, if you don't answer me, I will leave the church. And that's you. Remember, God say, be still and wait patiently for Him and do not fret because the people out there, you know, out there, they are doing, you know, things there and keep going on there. We live in this world. Sometimes we read own texts. They want, you know, why you sharing the sermon and preaching the message 3,000 years ago? Well, for yes, but people don't know the archaeology is still going out there. They want to say, oh, I found this artifact 3,000 years ago. A few weeks ago, I took the team going to the new airport. How many people know that we're going to have a new airport? Just about, 15 minutes away from here. They're going to open in 2026. I'm not interested about airport, but I'm interested about, when they excavate the airport, they found artifact. And when they find some artifact there, the whole airport being, postponed for some time. An artifact because people want to learn about what the past, which group of people living there, what this artifact for, and the archaeologists and they come in and investigate and they want to learn some of the past. And then with this psalm here, my psalmist, King David, wrote this psalm 3,000 years ago, and all these thousands, all these words still value today. It value greatly for you and family. And then in the verse, my beautiful verse, verse 11. Verse 11 say, but the meek will inherit the land and enjoy peace and prosperity. And Jesus say, blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. A true story. Last Wednesday, in my Bible study, I do Bible study with Tony in Chennai, and we're doing book of Proverbs, and we're doing chapter 17. And we talk about, sharing about, this and that. And suddenly, Tony was sharing another way. He said, very funny. And I happened, I just got in a full mouth of tea, and hear Tony and say, that's the right guy, he fear no people, but he afraid of my wife, Jenny. And then when he's hearing it, I just, burst into laughing. And you know what happened? The teeth on my mouth all going out all over the Bible. But the point is, because it's saying in the Bible, so the meek inherit the land. Here's the guy, long hair, and he's, unexpected. He's small, but God is small, but he's tough like stone. But he, what Tony said, but he's afraid of my wife, Jenny. And that myself, laughing, burst into laughing. Somebody in the world makes someone afraid. This guy, I'm sure he's not afraid of police, he's not afraid of anything, but if he's afraid of this very little, Janina, she's not little, she's young mom now, she's short, but she's very meek, she's a nurse, but here, the rash guy, so fearful of him, whatever he say, he agree. But that's a wonderful thing. That the reason why I laugh, because I just meditate on this verse in the Bible and also meditate on what Jesus say, the meek will inherit the earth. We see the war there, people using modern technology, people using all these kind of things to destroy each other to earn billions or even trillions. But still the word of Jesus say, the meek will inherit the land. The Bible, this one, the meek will inherit the land and enjoy peace and prosperity. The psalmist teaching you and teaching me is about, yes, if you delight in God, if you trust in God, if you commit your way in the Lord, of course, you can learn from Jesus. Being meek, Jesus say, come to me, all those who are weary and burdened in the heart, I will give you rest. I'm gentle in heart. And that's what Jesus say. Basically, Jesus say, be meek like me. It's not the rush. It's not the urgent. It's not the anger. It's not the weapon. It's not the people who wouldn't use this and that to destroy each other. But actually, the meek, the one who learned from Jesus, that's the one who inherit the earth. And going on, because I don't have much time there, I want you to go jump into verse 23 and verse 24, 25. This actually is one of the world's best personal testimony. Here's the testimony from the old man. David, when he wrote this psalm, he's all much older than me. And he say the word confirm is here, you know. They say, the verse 23 say, the Lord make firm step of those who are delighted in him. Though he may stumble, he will not fall, for the Lord opposed with him with his hand. And the verse 25 is testimony. Say, I was young and now I'm old. And yet I have never seen a righteous forsaken or the children begging for bread. This is, you see, you know, human being in the universe here is, if you're doing well this world, you need resilience. We all fail one upon the time in this life here. We fail this and we fail that. But after this, you have to remember, after verse 23, say, you know, I say the Lord will, he say, makes firm the step of one who delights in him, though he stumble. The Bible doesn't say, doesn't promise, say, you are not stumble. We own you. Ask the owners in this house, and he will tell you. Pastor David will say, yes. He say, he's supposed to be the owners, one in the father of the house. You're asking him, you know, how many times life stumble, he will tell you a lot. Asking me, you know, how many times you stumble, I say, there are plenty, uncountable. But the point is, we resilve. We stand up again, not because our will, but because we trust in the Lord. Doing well in this world is all about how resilient you are. Fall, but stand from it. Fall, but stand up from it. That's what the Bible says. But the verse 25 is beautiful. I was young and was old. And yet it is confirmed, you know, say, yeah, yet I have never seen a righteous forsaken or their children begging for bread. This is not just for one generation, okay? This verse is about the generations after. David is saying, yes, I'm sure I can see in my own eyes here, you know, the righteous will never be begging for bread. But he does not stop there. The testimony is the value because it's the children as well. How many of us can, you know, can give a testimony like King David? I mean, we all can have our personal testimony, for sure. But remember, the word of the Bible was saying, you know, the word of testimony is very good in the eyes of the Lord. But this one is saying, you know, it's telling you, you know, David, he was a shepherd young before. If you were a soldier, David say, I was. If you were a thinker, David say, I'm a thinker too. If you are a strategist, and say, yes, I am a strategist. And say, if you are a king, none of us can say, no, I'm a king. You can be a king of your home. You can be a king of your house. You can be a king of your children until your wife coming back. Yeah, we can have, you know, but King David say, if you are a king, David say, yes, I was a king. If you say, if you were, you know, this, if you were, you know, people who, you know, pretend to be mad or crazy, or, you know, this, David says, yes, I was sometime, you know, I have to, you know, the saliva come to my beard, and people say, oh, that dead dog, that's crazy. None of us, I can tell you in this church here, even in myself, 10 years living in prison, in a refugee camp, none of us had gone through the life like King David. But this is here, King David give this personal testimony and say, I was young and I'm old, but this one I say, I never see the righteous forsaken. Basically, God's eyes is upon you. And on God's eyes also upon your children and your descendants as well. So that's what in making you, you know, King David. You live in this world, you know, people, you know, they don't think much about children, indeed. They don't think much about grandchildren, you know. When, you know, little Evie, you know, come to my home, you know, she delights us. You know why? Because something just simple kids, you know, simple girl teaching you and teaching me something about life. Teaching you and teaching me about something, you know, as a family member. And I'm thinking, God, as the children and grandchildren and the great-grandchildren, is it the descendants that it might be from the blood, it might be from your spiritual, but remember, put it in your life, put it into your actions. God keep his promise. And David, you know, he is not just cheap testimony. He is the king. He is the emperor. He is the fighters. He is the poet. How many of you here a poet? Not so many of you. He is King David. He is a poet. How many of you are musician? Here, King David. He is a musician. He played before in the courtrooms. But he gives this testimony here. It's mean he lives. He's using this experience to telling you and telling me, say, let trust in the Lord. Let doing good. Let delight ourselves in the Lord. And it gives you the desire of the heart. On this verse in the Bible, giving you and giving me something wonderful that we keep living on. And in verse 34, I say, the hope in the Lord and keep his way. He will exalt your inner end. When the wicked are destroyed, you go see it. Because my time is don't have much here. Say, you know, the verse in verse 40, what say here? The Lord helps them and delivers them. He delivers them from the wicked and saves them because they take refuge in him. And this life here, sometimes we say, yes, I have plenty. Yes, I am blessed. Yes, I live in this city and have so many. But remember, God still expecting you and expecting me to take him as your refuge. Why? Only when you take delight in him, he can give you counsel. He gives you advice. He gives you the lead. He gives you the guide to go for the victory. If not being led by God, if not, you know, being delight in God, we tend to do something in our own will. We tend to do something in our own benefit. We tend to say something to benefit us. But the Lord, the end of this verse is saying, the Lord helps them and delivers them. He delivers them from the wicked and save them because they take delight in, it takes refuge in him. This psalm is a psalm teaching you and teaching me something about this world, even though we live in this modern world, even though information, even though, you know, getting technology and science can help you and help me to advance life much. And I say, please enjoy it. Please enjoy science. Please enjoy technology. Please enjoy whatever God is using the world to benefit you. But at the same time, the Bible want to tell you and telling me, coming back to God, let's learn how to trust him and him alone. That's why I put the title for this sermon is Life Only Worth Living When You Know How to Trust and Delight in God. You can trust, but you're not delight. But God wants you to be both. God expects all of us to trust God and delight in him. He will lead you and us to go through life just like COVID. Now we're talking of COVID about something yesterday. But still remember, things might happen again in the future. I don't know when and how, because Jesus said, you know, you will see this. If you read in Matthew 24, things happen. It's life. God wants to show you. God wants to lead you. God wants to guide you. But at the same time, we must trust in God, delight in him, and he gives you the desires of the heart. And the Bible says, the meek will inherit the land. And the people who take refuge in him will be rescued. Amen. Thank you, Father, Lord God, for today. God, we only learn from you. You want to show us how to live victoriously in this life by trusting in you. Lord, also put an effort in doing good. Let your seed sown within us have a time to germinate and bear the fruit. Thank you, Lord God, let us working together, one soul, one harvest. Lord God, just be with us. Guide us into your way, making you the center of our life. Let we sing the song, let we worship in you, make it meaningful into our heart, into our mind. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Shall we stand to us? Shall we stand? Yes. Sorry, guys.
At the cross, I bow my knee. Where your blood was shed for me, there's no greater love than this.
Let's sing it out. You have overcome.
You have overcome the grave. Your glory fills the highest place. What could separate me now?
Let's sing at the cross.
At the cross I bow my knee. Where your blood was shed for me, there's no greater love than this. You have overcome the grave, your glory fills the highest place. What could separate me now?
Even though the food's out there, but the altar is open, if you want us to pray with you, please come fast, and then we can go out there and have garlic and onions. And sausage.
You told
the veil, you made a way when you said that it is done. You told the veil, you made a way when you said. You made a way when you said that it is done. You tore the veil. You made a way when you said that it is done.
Sing at the cross.
At the cross I bow my knee, where your blood was shed for me, there's no greater love than this. You have overcome the grave, your glory fills the highest place. What could separate me?
Thank you, Lord. Father, we just thank you for this time together. Father, as we go from this place, Lord, we thank you that your grace goes with us. Lord, bless each one as we go in Jesus' name. And Father, we just also pray for the food. We ask your blessing on the time of fellowship and food together after the service. Bless each one, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. So you don't have to pray out there. We've already prayed.
Just a quick announcement. Can we have around 20 young people help?